Alright, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com to have another exciting episode for you, coming at you from my backyard garden with my kale bed growing amazing after that last video. I did do what I said in the video. I did basically every day. I think I missed a day and then I skipped a day. But basically I applied my three different treatments, even applied a fourth treatment. I forget, somebody sent it to me. For my plants. So look at these guys, man. I mean, they're seriously grown so nice. They're looking so much healthier. They've greened up and they're off to a really amazing start. So if you didn't see my last episode on what I spray on my transplants after transplanting, check that video out. Link is down below. Soon enough, I will also be spraying this with some compost tea that I'm going to probably start to brew maybe tomorrow. So the topic of this episode is a Q&A. I'm going to go ahead and answer your guys' questions. I get a lot of questions. I have over 750,000 subscribers on my YouTube channel now, which is completely insane. And I apologize, I can't answer every single question that people message me over different various social media outlets, even below my videos on YouTube. I have over 1,500 videos and I just can't keep up with everything. I could barely get my garden watered and planted and make my own food fresh and dry my peppers, man, and get my work done and clean my house. Well, I can't even get to cleaning my house, actually. But nonetheless, in this episode, I'll be answering your questions right here. I've printed out. If you do have a question you'd like to submit for the next Q&A, I'll put a link down below to the community tab on YouTube where I will pull questions that are asked from the community tab into next month's video. All right, the next thing I will say is that I do have a way you could talk to me personally for just $5 plus service fee from Fiverr. I will give you a call anywhere in the United States for 10 minutes. You could get longer if you'd like, and I'll do my best to answer your questions. Now, please be aware, I know a lot, but I don't know everything, and sometimes people have, what do I do for this, John, or what do I do for this? And I'll tell them, I don't know the answer, because I haven't had direct experience with that, you know. But in many cases, you know, I will know who to lead you to or a place to call for the answer if I don't know the answer. So I'm also good at that also. And all the money that comes in to me from the Fiverr basically goes back into the Fiverr community to help get my videos transcribed so that people with hearing impairment or that speak a foreign language can have access to the content in my videos. So I want to thank you guys who have support me with that mission there. I do not pull any money out of Fiverr. All right, on with today's episode. We have a ton of questions here, and I'm going to try to get to them as quickly as I can. All right, the first question is from William Ruiz. Please give me a quick call so I can have your number. I plan becoming a vertical tower gardener. I want to learn how to grow kale, lettuce, and other plants. Thank you. All right, William, so I apologize. I don't give people calls, and more importantly, I don't give anybody my number because I could not handle, even 100,000 or even 1,000 people having my personal home phone number and getting calls in the middle of the day and people asking me questions. And I just don't have the time. I can't get everything done I even need to get done in the day. So only close friends and family actually have my personal home phone number. But if you do want to talk to me, I will call you. It'll be from a call-restricted number. Once again, link is down below to sign up for my Fiverr, and I'm glad to give you a call, and I will tell you that I have grown many things vertically, and, you know, some tower gardens, like the hydroponic tower garden, I'm not a fan of. There's a vertical tower garden that's soil-based with a little tube in the middle. I'm not the biggest fan of that. I think there are better solutions that are far less money, that work better. So I will say that. All right, next question is from Renee White. 4 years ago, you made a compost Tumblr video. I've heard a local person who can make compost in 3 hours. It's a machine that does it. Do you know anything about it? What is your opinion on the best composter in 2020? All right, Renee, yes. So I'm still using my composters. I have had some challenges with rusting on my drawer form, so I need to contact a company to see if I can get that taken care of and what they would do for people that would have a similar situation than I. You know, it hasn't rained where I live now for 170 days, which means that it's not, you know, resting because of the rain. It's due to the moisture content inside, which I try to keep about appropriate by adding enough dry material in there, but still it's having some issues with rust. So I'm not super happy about that. Let's see, the composter in 3 hours. So technically, I've seen those machines. I have one. Actually, I think Vitamix is now selling it. It's technically not a composter, so let's not get mixed up with that. Basically, what it does, it basically is like a dehydrator and a turner and a grinder, basically. And it's like $400. Vitamix now sells it. I think I'll pull out mine and make a review one of these days when I get some time. And I did use it when I first got it, and it does work, but it doesn't make compost. It basically literally takes your food scraps, your food waste, and dehydrates it, and yes, reduces the volume considerably, but a similar process could be done by taking all your food scraps, putting it in your oven, and turning the oven on and basically cooking down your food to remove the moisture content, and then put that in your high power blender and grind it all up, or even a food processor at that point, and then you could basically have this, I mean, they call it a compost. It's not really a compost. It's basically just ground up food that's dried. So, and that wastes extra electricity by using your oven, and then extra electricity from using your blender to grind it up. This machine does it all in one step for you. A little bit convenient. Maybe if you're in an apartment in New York City, it might be a good thing. But even better than that is, why do we need all these complicated things in life, right? Some cases, they can be good. But in this case, in my opinion, you could take your food scraps, just dig a hole and bury them, man. And then now there's the water content in there, and water is essential for life. So why heat it off or cook it off and reduce it down unless you just want to make your food scraps more compacted so that you could deal with it? There's no, here's the thing. Compost could take weeks. Maybe you could get it down to like a month or so in my tumblers. That being said, all compost is different. Just because you made compost doesn't mean it's a good compost. And that's a topic for a whole different episode, actually. So what I will say is the best composter in 2020 that I'm aware of is called the Sue Johnson Bioreactor. S-U-J-O-H-N-S-O-N Bioreactor. Look up videos on YouTube. Professor from Albuquerque came up with it. It's a slow composting method. It could take 6 months to a year to make the compost in the method with the Sue Johnson Bioreactor, but it's the best. Now, why am I saying it's the best? It's not the fastest, but it's the best in terms of creating the most soil fertility. And as a gardener, you know, my goal is to make the highest soil fertility and create the best compost. It's gonna have a diversity of fungi and bacteria, most basically compost that are made quickly, like in windrows at compost facilities, are made very quickly, and they might have high bacteria, but you're missing the fungi and the fun girls. Well, that was a joke. But we want the fungi and maybe even the fun girls in the soil because they really ramp up your production. All right, next question is from Min Nijen. Hi, John. Are you selling Ashitaba seeds? If you do, then how can I place an order? Thank you. All right, Min. So I have Ashitaba seeds actually in my greenhouse sitting that's been drying. Viability is not the best on them, but I do have them. The challenge is this. I don't have time to personally sell them. I have collected them, I'm saving them. I'll probably spread them out in my garden and grow more. The challenge was when I had a girlfriend, she would basically get all the seeds from me and she would sell them, and then she would basically just get to keep the money because I was like, I was just helping her out so she could have a job and she could do something and also, more importantly, fulfill my mission to get the seeds out to people. You know, while it is important for me to spread the seeds and spread genetic diversity to people, it's also important for me to have enough time, and it's just not worth my time to, you know, pack up seeds and mail them out for $5 or whatever. You know, it's not my priority at this point. There are other places you can buy Ashitaba seeds, maybe strictly medicinal seeds is a place I'd recommend if you guys are looking for them. I think they're fairly reliable, and I actually would encourage you to get the red stem variety. I haven't experimented with that myself yet. They have it. Next question is from Matt McBride. I'm finding rusted nails here and there in said to be all natural organic garden soil. Their sites, articles, videos claiming rusty nails will not harm the plants, thus not harming you when you consume the plants after harvest. There's a lot of mixed info in this, and I'm not sure if you've covered it before. I will keep looking. Thanks for all you do. Cheers. All right, Matt, I think I probably talked about rusted nails at some point, but you probably would have had a problem finding it. So what I will say is this. All natural and organic gardening soils is basically usually coming from municipalities where people are putting who knows what in their green bin you know, or yard waste, maybe put in like, you know, pallets or, you know, fences with nails in it, then it gets composted down and then the nails don't compost like the organic matter does. And now you're left with nails and the compost facility. They should kind of have some kind of strong magnet to suck these nails out, or at least be properly screening the materials before they send it out, so it shouldn't even be in there in the first place, okay? That's number one. I don't put nails in my garden. the other thing I will say is that I personally believe if nails, and they're just properly, you know, coated nails, like made out of iron, they're gonna rust, and there's no other chemicals or spraying on the nails, like galvanized nails or whatever. I don't know all the different coatings they add on nails these days. If it's just steel nails that are rusting and it's made out of iron and it's rusting in your garden, that's probably a good thing to some level. Some people claim the iron may not be able to be absorbed, so you might have to like leach them in acid, like our urine, you know, to basically get the iron in a more chelated form so the plants could absorb it. I don't really know about that stuff. But what I will tell you is, you know, if I found nails in my garden, I would pull them out. And the main reason is because they can hurt us, right? If it's in your soil and you're eating plants that got the iron from the nails, it's fine. Now, the other issue is, you know, there's bacteria that can live on rusty surfaces, such as tetanus. So, you know, you get a tetanus shot so you don't get tetanus. And, you know, I'm concerned about these microbes that can potentially live on rusty nails in the right environment, in the right conditions. And then if we put our hands in the soil and then we get cut through the rusted nail, that could definitely not be a good thing. So that's probably my biggest concern about that. You know, if there's microbes in the soil, if you have a good population of healthy microbes, it's always going to keep the bad microbes in check. And I don't think you could get tetanus from eating, you know, iron rusted nail kale leaves, for example. So yeah, don't cut yourself, pull them out and discard them. If you do want to add iron to your soil, you could get a big like milk gallon jug and put real nails in there and then pee in there, let it sit for like a week or two, shake it up a little bit, and then you know, maybe put in the sun, although it will degrade the plastic, and then you could like pour that out diluted on your plants for additional iron. All right. Next question is from Amber Clark. I'm starting a small raised bed garden in Mont Bellevue, Texas. We're east of Houston. I've been watching videos and so excited to start, but have found out Houston is supposed to be one of the hardest places to have a garden in the country. I'm not looking to grow anything exotic, just the usual suspects. What can we successfully grow here? All right, Amber. So I'd love to live in Houston. Actually, Houston, on some levels, is even easier to grow stuff than Las Vegas or Phoenix, which is one of the hardest places in the country. I would not say Houston is one of the hardest places in the country by any means. And this is why I know why, because I got my girlfriend's parents started out with their own garden. And then one year I came there and I basically bought a bunch of plant starts from my favorite nursery. I think it's called JRN Nursery in Houston. If I remember, I'll put a link down below to that video. And they sell some amazing plants that are perfect for growing in Houston. You'll have the utmost success if you plant the plants that I go over in that episode, right? Because those plants are adapted to the nice warm weather, the humid weather, and the hot weather, right? Wait, I think I said warm and hot twice. But nonetheless, those are the plants that are going to do well. And every summer, my ex-girlfriend's parents probably cursed me out to some extent, because they cannot get rid of the moringa, they cannot get rid of the Malabar spinach, they cannot get rid of the katuk, and they cannot get rid of the Malabar spinach that just comes back every year without them doing anything. So they already have an automatic garden. Now the challenge is, you know, I wish they would eat more of those greens. Those are some nutritious greens, but most people don't know how to use and cook or eat those greens. All those greens can be eaten raw in salad. You could turn them into green smoothies, and you could even juice them. I think Malabar spinach juice would probably make it pretty gelatinous. Actually, I gotta try that one. I haven't done that one before. But nonetheless, you gotta grow the things that grow best. Also visit a gardener that does a permaculture in his backyard. If I remember, put a link down below to that video so you can see what he's growing, right? You gotta grow the right plants for your specific climate and area. I know there's a big plant or a big tree sale every year in Houston, so I would encourage you to go to that tree sale, because at the, I think it's Urban Harvest Tree Sale, they're only going to sell you guys the trees that are going to grow well in your area, unlike the JRN Nursery that may sell more tropical things that may not be quite as successful. And then as to other items growing, most common vegetables that you're familiar with are best to be grown in the winter season there in Houston. In the summer, it can be especially difficult to grow certain items. I would encourage you, and I visited when I was out there, they have like a master gardeners, I forget the county, is it Brazos County, whatever county it is, I visited the master gardeners out there, and they have amazing demonstration little garden, and you know, they have references online, so look at Master Gardeners Houston, and they'll have planting lists, and more importantly, when you could plant the certain items and which plants will do better than not. All right, next question is from Kevin J. Wilson. Hello, John. Have you heard of plant bioresponsive irrigation tape? This tape only releases through millions of small micropores in response to a sugar exudate from a plant root. Plants are never water-stressed nor overwatered. When the plant has sufficient water, the sugar exudate stops and the tape stops weeping. Dramatically less water usage and improved yield. I use it in my veggie garden. It's responsivedrip.com. All right, Kevin, I have not heard of this. I did look it up, and actually I am in contact with them to learn more about it and even convert over some of my raised beds maybe next season. These beds here have the aqua jet irrigation, and I'm really not happy with it. I'm about to pull the whole doggone thing out. Not happening. I've been actually using the aqua jet below, which I kind of like it, having it below. It's not really seen. And then I've basically been using some drip on top for this past summer, which actually I was able to keep things alive without the drip on top. You know, things don't do well. The spacing's not right, and I'm just not comfortable with how the system is designed nor works, or the customer service I've gotten from Rob there at Intelligent Irrigation LLC. So that's my personal opinion on that. So I'm looking forward to trying a different kind of setup, because I'm not a big fan of running all this irrigation stuff on top. I really like that hidden stuff underneath. It just looks a lot cleaner. I have been hand watering these guys basically once a day, and soon enough I'll put the irrigation on top. And then I still got the aqua jet underneath, which I think is good. I'm probably not going to rip it out, because it could still inject air in the root zone to encourage soil microbes, which I like. Next question is from Pearly King. What is your opinion on using milorganite in your yard and garden? I don't think it is organic, but is it better than big brand fertilizers? You may have gotten this question before, but I don't know how to search your channel for it. All right, Pearly. So, to search my channel, if you go just to Growing Your Greens, my channel page, or just go to growingyourgreens.com, there's a little, if you go halfway down, there's like a whole bunch of things, and there's like a little magnifying glass. Put in the magnifying glass right there, and then type in milorganite, and it'll search all my videos for that specific keyword. I probably keyworded the video that I talked about this product. Even though it ends in organite, you might think, oh, it's like organic. And I guess it is on some level organic, because it is from nature. It's basically human poop, I guess, from Milwaukee. And they basically compost it, and then they sell it to you. So I do not recommend using milorganite or any kind of biosolids, you know, from municipalities in your garden. That being said, if you know the source, right, on any manure, whether it's our manure, which is human manure, or we are an animal after all, or other animal manures like cows, pigs, sheep, rabbits, hens, you know, donkeys, I mean, whatever, horses, whatever you got, right? Know the source, right? If I, and I don't do this currently, it's on my list to do one day when I go off the grid, I'm gonna compost my own manure and my own family's manure and compost it properly, make sure it's properly done so it's safe, because if we're using our own manures or even other animal manures, it can contain contaminants. And so I would not trust what people flush down their toilet in Milwaukee, because most people are eating a GMO diet, taking drugs. Sometimes when they got extra drugs, they put them down the toilet to flush them to get rid of them. You're not supposed to do that with drugs. You're supposed to take it to your local drug recycling center or whatever, you know, hazardous waste disposal place, as well as, you know, in big, like, industrial areas, I'll pour extra paint thinner or paint down the sink just to get rid of it. Not the way to dispose of that, guys, either, you know. And so there's all kinds of nasty things that go into the waste system. So I do not recommend you guys using that. I mean, I like that they're actually using human waste, but I don't think it's good for food crops. Now, if you want to put it on your lawn, I'd have less issues with that, because it's a, you know, way of, you know, reusing a manure, basically, human manure. The issue I have is all the other things are being flushed with the human manure and the quality of the human manure, because I don't know what most people are eating, and they probably ain't eating too good. So I would probably just personally steer clear of that product altogether, and I would, if you wanted something, you know, I'd really look for other even brand names of organic certified. Make sure you have the organic certified. At least that means something, although it could be organic certified chicken manure, because most organic fertilizers are based on manures or blood or bone meal, which I am personally not a fan of. So you'll have to check my other videos for some other fertilizer recommendations. I guess off the top of my head, if I had to recommend one brand of fertilizer, actually I think it's being sold in Home Depot now, it's a Dr. Earth's fertilizer. So they don't use any kind of, you know, porcine or cow manures or chicken manures. They use other sources of, you know, nutrients for your garden. All right, so that's my answer. Let's see, next question is from Gully88. Talk to me about tilling. I've heard it bad, but I also know people that do it every year. I want to have a sustainable garden indefinitely that will feed the soul as much as it will feed my family. I live in Maine on the coast, so we have a milder winter compared to more inland areas. I've been gardening for 3 years now, and my garden isn't producing like I'd like it to. I seem to have hard packed soil, and though tilling in the spring would help this to root down deeper, but I don't want to ruin the ground. I feel a little over my head and need a hand. Love your channel. Thanks for all the help you've unknowingly given me. All right, Gully. So what I'd recommend is this, you know, a lot of people eat McDonald's every day. Just like a lot of gardeners till their garden, or a lot of farms till their garden. It doesn't mean it's right, and I'm not going to judge anybody that chooses to eat at McDonald's. You know, I'm going to say that in my personal opinion, you know, eating at McDonald's is really super unhealthy for the person who's eating it, because it's highly processed foods, it's GMO foods, it's everything you don't want to eat. It's fried foods, it's, you know, high fat foods, it's low phytonutrients, low vitamins, minerals, and foods, but it is high calorie. And so it gives you that burst of energy, and you eat for cheap because maybe you can get something on the dollar menu, and you're off and running, and you're doing pretty good until you die of a heart attack one day because you ate too much of it, right? I mean, they have things like, you know, Super Size Me, where the guy ate McDonald's for 30 days and you could see what happens, right? Well, guess what? The same thing happens when you till your ground. If you till your ground every year, your ground depends on being tilled. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy that if you till and you keep tilling, it ruins the soil structure. It kills the microbes. It tears up the earthworms. And more importantly, it messes up the fungal networks in the ground. And this is not a good thing. Like if you buy a brand new piece of land, you're going to, you know, garden on it for the first time, maybe a one-time initial plow just to kind of get the ground working, to get things up, to get it moving. And when you till it up, enrich it. But then I would, you know, not till again. So don't invest in a tiller. Maybe borrow one or rent one to get a one-time till. That being said, I would prefer not even to till in the first place. I would just pile up soil on top of the ground and then grow in that. Like, I built a frame around the soil, which is actually a raised bed, but you don't even need a frame. You could just pile up a mound of compost and then plant in that and have that leach down. Now, of course, the other issue you'll have is the weeds down below, and they'll be growing through your compost, and then you're going to want to sheet mulch with cardboard. You know, there's a very impressive farm, Singing Frog Farms. I haven't got out there yet. I've asked them to come out maybe a couple times, but they haven't been able to accommodate my schedule. And basically they just do a no-till farm, and they are very productive. So you know, getting started with no-till may feel challenging because it is different than what everybody else is doing and what everybody else is telling you. But let me tell you, it is the way of the future. I mean, if you look up the NRCS, right? That's a National Soil Conservation Service. It's a division of the USDA, US government, right? They encourage farmers not to till their farms. But it's like this old culture is that we gotta till. And guess what? Tilling and chemical fertilizers cause the destruction of basically the plain states and the soil. And then adding all the basically fertilizers. So the problem is, you know, the synthetic, you know, water-soluble fertilizers in tilling primarily, in my opinion. And so we really want to get back to not doing those things. I mean, in the forest, is there tillers that's tilling the forest? But the forest is nice and lush. In the prairie lands, is there tillers that are tilling the prairie lands? I mean, maybe some pigs are kind of roughing up certain areas and kind of tilling it on some levels to get their food to dig down, you know, their whatever they're digging and eating up. But it's just not good on wide scale. So I encourage you not to do that. So how will you till? How will you break up the soil? Well, you want to do the natural method. So how I would do this, and I made videos on this before, is you want to spray down lots of beneficial microbes. I mean, my last episode, I sprayed down microbes. I wouldn't necessarily use those to invigorate your soil because it might get kind of expensive, but you use a very low concentration. You know, I made a video where actually I showed my backyard here before it had all these raised beds, and I talked about this very topic, and there's different kind of microbial inoculants you can spray down, you know. We want to add these microbes and bacteria and fungi, which basically will create airspace in your soil. We want to add things in like earthworms that go in and they will till your soil naturally, but not disturb it in the way a tiller would. You know, they're going to create passageways and airways in the soil. They're going to basically make their worm castings, their worm poop, enrich your soil. This is the natural way of things, and we've lost the soil microbiome, the bacteria and the fungi. I want you to read a book, right? And then tell me if you still want to till, right? It's by Jeff Lowenfels, and the book is called Teeming with Microbes. So yeah, check out that book, and that should get you on a pretty good path to a better understanding of how to garden in a more natural method, all right? Let's see, next question is from Todd Sheldon. Have you ever had problems with Scarlett runner beans not setting beans? My plants have been flowering a couple months, but have set absolutely no fruit. Plenty of pollinators around. Could it simply be the warm night temps? All right, Todd. So yeah, I don't know where you live. So, you know, what I will say is that in my Northern California location, about in about an hour north of San Francisco, runner beans, no problem. I grew them in Las Vegas, Nevada, you know, one of my favorite plants. And I tried it a couple years and I just don't even try to grow them anymore because in the hot summers and our night temps are really warm, and I'm not sure exactly if it's because of the day temps or the night temps, but it grew pretty good, but then it never made a bean. Maybe it made three beans right when the weather started cooled down, but then it frosted and I lost it, right? So you know, what we really need to do is we need to kind of look at where was the runner beans originally grown in, and is that your climate zone? If it is, then you got some other issues, and if it isn't, then I would probably say it's climate, but I don't know exactly where you live, all right? If you live in like Phoenix or Vegas, I'm probably gonna say it's too hot. Maybe even some areas of Southern California might be too warm, not exactly sure. All right, next question is from Elock909. Hi, John, I just watched your show about agardentreasure.com, which is soil microbes. I would like to get some, but I can't connect with a website. Okay, so I don't know whatever happened to that company. That company was buying this product SC25 or something, and then repackaging it and then selling it in a small format so that I would be affordable for gardeners. And I don't know if they're even in business anymore. What I will say is actually my last episode, I talked about the Soil Balance Pro product. It was the first thing I held up actually after the mycorrhizae product. And actually I put that on this garden, on this bed, and it's doing great. I would highly encourage people to use that. If you want to get some of that stuff, the new website to buy that, the same stuff, or even the improved version, is soilbalancepro.com. You know, I negotiated special discount for my viewers, a 25% off coupon. Just type in growing your greens. And I want you guys to be aware, on all the coupons on my gardening channel, I don't get any monetary kickbacks, right, from the companies. What I tell the companies when I am going to review a product, I reach out to them and say, hey, I'm going to review your product. Would you like me to include a coupon code for my viewers? Because I want them to get a discount so that they could afford some of these, in some cases, more expensive gardening products, right? And I say, instead of giving me the commission that you might with a normal influencer, I want you to discount your product even more so that my viewers can afford it. You know, and this is how I think, because, you know, I got a good, you know, job and business and all that stuff, and I make okay money. I'm not like a billionaire, quadrillionaire, or like, I don't know as much money as Donald Trump does, supposedly, or in debt or nothing, but I do all right. I live a nice, comfortable life, and, you know, it's more important for me to be able to allow you guys to have a good price on some of these products I use that can get quite spendy, because I want you to grow a higher quality food. I want you to do what's right for the planet, to put in microbes so that you don't have to till, so that you have better results and better success, instead of me getting some fiat cash that's only as good as much as we put a value on it, because intrinsically it has no value and it's not even backed up by gold anymore. So that's my opinions on that, all right? So yeah, Soil Balance Pro, growing your greens for 25% off, all right? Next question is from Sir Sticky, and actually it was posted underneath the last video I did, where I'm actually talking about the Soil Balance Pro, the mycorrhiza, and the kelp, and the fulvic acid that I was using on this bed. And the question is, pushing bottles now, selling out, I see. Right. So here's the thing, right? I have always talked about products on my channel. I've never proclaimed being a frugal gardener. I mean, there's websites on, you know, YouTube channels are frugal gardening and all this stuff where you could garden with no cash or no money and using only what you got. I applaud the people that choose to live or choose to grow a frugal garden. I strive to have as many garden videos on frugal gardening and how to do it without buying stuff. I like to show you guys the gamut of how to grow food, whether you want to buy some products to do that or whether you want to do it yourself. There's always ways around buying some products in most cases, although some of the specific things may be a little more difficult. And you know, for me, it comes down to, why am I gardening? Is my garden here just to save the most money so I can have more food and do it as cheaply as possible? It's quite unfortunate that in our society, we equate cheap with good and maybe expensive for some people with bad. I think money can be used appropriately and to get good soil nutrients so that you could have a higher quality food, which will then make us and our brains function better, in my personal opinion, if we're eating the food, and give us phytonutrients and different trace minerals in our foods that's not gonna be in conventional grown produce, even organic grown produce, using, you know, chicken manure or cow manure as fertilizer. I think that's beneficial personally. And my goal and why I'm growing a garden from the get-go, right, has always to been have higher quality food and have food literally money cannot buy. And maybe that's your goal, to have high quality food, because I've learned that the higher quality the food, the higher quality the person you are. I like to also think that the higher quality food you eat, the better you think. I mean, actually, there's books written on this topic. There's a book called Crazy Makers, and it's how fast food basically makes you crazy, right? And, you know, I'm not going to get into that any more than this, but, you know, my goal is to grow high quality food, and yeah, if I got to spend a little bit of money to buy some stuff to do that, I will. That being said, as I just told you in the last question, you know, I get a discount for you guys so you guys can afford it, and I don't take a kickback. Now, the companies do send me some free products so that I can use, test, evaluate, and promote them, which, you know, which I'm grateful for, honestly, because then I could use the products also and show you guys what it does and show you guys the success or failures that I get with those products. And I promote the products, of course, that work for me in my garden. Okay? And then, yeah, so, I mean, here's the thing. Like, if you don't want to buy all those products that I showed in the last episode, you absolutely don't have to. Don't buy them. I don't care, man. Do what you guys want to do. Here's the thing, though. What I will say is that we do need to add trace minerals and microbes to the soil and other adjuncts that can increase their uptake in your soil. However you want to do that. Hey, if you live by the coast, get your own seaweed, make sure you wash it really good to get the salt out, and then compost it in your compost bin, and then spread that and you get the seaweed thing covered. Boom, done. You know, if you want to get more microbes, then make your own compost in what through different methods, like, you know, old school, like wood chip compost to get some good fungal action, get a heat pile to like get some bacterial action, and then more importantly, get your own worms or other insects like mealworms or even millipedes if you can in your climate zone, and use their frass in your compost tea. So you can make your own compost tea and then spread that out. Compost tea could basically take the place of a properly made compost tea, and then make sure you get the trace minerals from different rock dusts or ocean water, however you guys want to get those. I don't really care, but we need the trace minerals, the microbes, and the fungi, because that's what really makes this work. And buying and using a couple bottles, or sometimes some of those things are not in bottles, they're in packages. You know, I don't know if it makes a difference. I know Josh, my buddy, my frenemy Josh, he hates things in liquids, but he's fine with things in their solid form, right? But yet he sells neem oil. So anyways, life's complicated. So yeah, do what you guys can do. All right, next question is from Wee Wee, also about my last video I posted. I really enjoyed your content. What do you suggest for your viewers who can't afford the pricey supplements for your garden that you're using? Would you recommend one product? Yes, I would, right? So if you can't afford the products I showed in the last episode, I'll give you guys options, right? And the best single option you guys could get, as I talked about in the last episode, is compost tea. Now, the best compost tea that I personally found is the Boogie Brew compost tea. If I remember, I'll put a link down below to the website to purchase that. It's boogiebrew.net/GYG. I've negotiated, once again, special pricing through Josh for my viewers, so you guys could have the lowest price. He hates me sometimes because all the business I send him. But that is the single one item you can get that will almost replace the three items I show. I mean, here's the thing. Josh uses like a fulvic or humic acid in his compost tea. He uses the worm castings. He uses a fungal-dominated compost, supposedly. He also uses the kelp, you know, like I showed in the video. So he basically covers all the bases, although it doesn't exactly have the same exact set of microbes that I'm adding here, which may be a little better. And he doesn't have the mycorrhizal fungi. So then I would say get the Plant Success Mycorrhizae, number one, and number two, get the Boogie Brew compost tea, and then call it a day. That's gonna get you really close to what I'm doing. I mean, I'm gonna be adding Josh's compost tea. I'm gonna brew it in just a couple days, and I'm gonna get that out there too. And my personal opinion on gardening, because I'm not the guy that went to college for all this stuff to get soil tests and all this stuff, I just give it, like, it's like if you have relatives coming in from out of town that you never met before, right? And you want to go to a Japanese, your wife might want to take them to the, you know, Chinese place or the Mexican place. But maybe they love, I don't know what they're going to love, what kind of food they're going to love, right? But if you take them to a smorgasbord, right, or a buffet, especially here in Vegas, that has every different kind of food, they will find something they like to eat, right? And that's my idea with the soil, right? I'm going to give my plants the smorgasbord, as many different microbes and fungi and bacteria, and as many different trace minerals in proper soil balance that nature would naturally provide, of course, and then let them figure out what they want to uptake, what bacteria and what microbes and what fungi are going to flourish in my garden, in my particular space. But because here's the thing, if they're not in there in the first place, they're likely not going to magically appear, you know. So I really believe that to be super critical and important, and I would encourage you guys to maybe live by this philosophy just a little bit. All right, on to the last set of questions. Actually, I don't have the person that actually asked me this question, but it's, what do you do with all your peppers? Can you juice them? Can you lend me some great recipes? All right, so I just harvested peppers. These are gonna get dried, actually, myself. I'm gonna dry these in just a little bit today. But what do I do with all my peppers? So I eat them fresh. That's A, number one, right? I will dry them. That's number two. Number three, I will ferment them. That's number four, I don't know. I will juice them and I will make recipes out of them. So for example, you know, one of the things I like to do, I just like to take a bunch of fresh peppers and I'll put them in the blender with maybe some fresh tomatoes, maybe some nuts and seeds, maybe some macadamia nuts, maybe like some taco seasoning, and then I could basically have a taco seasoning style pepper tomato based dip, right? It's got some of my homegrown peppers or tomatoes in there with some nuts and seeds for a little bit of fat to make it taste good, and some different herbs and spices. You know, whether you want to use some kind of, I don't know, pizza seasoning or Italian seasoning, you could use it as like a topping for your pizza. You know, that's what I do with this stuff. You could use it to like dip in fresh zucchini or use that actually similar recipe as a dressing for a salad. You know, you could also juice the peppers. I'll also juice peppers to make a pepper-based soup, which is based around basically pepper juice. I mean, there's so many, you could cook them up. I'm not a big fan of cooking up stuff, my food, because you can lose nutrients, especially some of the antioxidants in there. So yeah, I hope that gives you some ideas. I don't know if I have a video on fermenting peppers. I probably do. So if you search my channel, you'll see a video on that. You could also make kale chips with them. So I could basically blend up the peppers, tomatoes, some herbs and spices with some nuts, get kale, and then just basically coat them up and then basically dehydrate it. You could have kale chips based on your own peppers. I mean, a simpler recipe would be just blend up some peppers, maybe a little bit of vinegar, not too much, and some oil. If you use oil, I prefer to use nuts instead of oil because oil is very high calorie food. And then and just coat your kale with that and then dehydrate it or put it in your oven if you don't have a dehydrator at a low temperature to basically preserve it and lock them in. I mean, the other thing is the dried peppers are amazing. I have peppers now, but just in a couple 4 months, peppers will no longer be in season because it's gonna be too cold here. And then I could basically use my dried peppers all winter long until I get to next summer and I could have my fresh peppers again. So that way I don't have to buy too many peppers from the store. Right, next question is from Pink Salt. Do people use human poo in worm bins? I've heard of human compost, but still not clear, thank you. All right, Pink Salt. So I did a video with my friend Paul Neeson in Florida, and he will make human manure or humanure. So I would encourage you to look up humanure. You know, that's basically your composting, your own manure to use. I do not recommend using that on vegetable plants, maybe on big fruit trees, and definitely burying it under the ground. And more importantly, if you're gonna choose to embark on the humanure journey, make sure it's properly composted and you abide by the temperature rules. It's supposed to get a certain temperature to make sure all the bad things are burnt off before you use it. You could completely do that. I've never heard of anybody feeding human poo to worms. That might sound disgusting to some, but please be aware that most worm castings are made out of horse or even cow manure. And, you know, I personally think my manure is a bit cleaner than probably cow manure coming out of a factory farm eating GMO stuff that's been sprayed with glyphosate. Personally, I mean, that's just my opinion. Yeah, so I would have to look more into feeding them to worms, but normally I have never heard of that being done. What you might want to do, another safe way to make the, you know, compost your own human manure is through bokashi fermentation. So they might call bokashi composting. Technically it's not. You're basically going to put it in a bokashi bucket and basically ferment your poop. All the bacteria is going to eat your poop, eat all the bad stuff, then you're going to get this basically fermentation out of it, and then you would then compost that. So it's another intermediary step to break down your poo to make it safer before you do the final end compost or just dig a hole and bury it. I know they do that with cat and even dog manure if you want to be more sustainable about your pet manure. All right, next question is from Tara Webster. Canaf, advice on consuming raw canaf greens in salads, juicing a lot or use sparingly. All right, so that's interesting. Canaf or hibiscus cannabiscus or cannabiscus. I did a video once when I visited the dude in Tampa area, brought back a plant for me, didn't make it. But yeah, that's a really cool plant. So canaf is known as a fiber, but many people don't know, I think it's from like Africa, but many people don't know the leaves are also completely edible and delicious. They kind of taste like sorrel-y. So for me, I would personally use it like I would a sorrel. You know, I wouldn't necessarily juice a ton of it. it can be a little bit strong and whatnot. If you cook it down, I suppose you could probably eat more of it. How I would use it personally is I'd actually just make a mixed salad with it. So, you know, if I had all my kale and lettuce, I'd pick kale lettuce and put some canaf leaves in there and eat them. I would feel fine. I've not done specific research on canaf. I know some greens in high quantities may not be so good. It is a hibiscus family plant, and I've eaten many other hibiscus family plants in larger quantities, like the roselle and the false roselle, and even the bayley, you know, which is actually a hibiscus manuhot, which is related closely to hibiscus. And I would use those in basically unlimited quantities, but pay attention and be aware. Yeah. Let's see. Next question is from M.E. Do you prefer cut and come again, leaving one third the plant, or pick and come again, lower leaves for lettuce, kale? Does one practice prolong harvest time and slow down bolting? That's a good question. So I personally prefer the pick and come again method of harvesting, right? It's like, you know, I could see this kale plant here and I could just pinch off the whole top. I feel that it would take a lot longer for that plant to regrow from, you know, just a few leaves that are left on the bottom, if you even left any leaves, because I know on lettuces sometimes they just almost cut them into the ground and they just come back. While the root zone is in place and can make things happen, you know, I really want those solar panels, which are the leaves, to get the sun's energy. They convert that to sugars. I believe they will grow faster in that method. Personally, although it is more labor. So if you're on a big farm, that's why they usually just do cut and come again, because they get come with a, you know, harvester and just harvest it off, send it off, wash it, and ship it out instead of picking individual leaves. So that's my personal preference, and that's what I personally choose to do. I have not done side-by-side comparisons to see which one will prolong the harvest, and I don't really know the answer to that, but I prefer the cut or pick and come again than cut and come again, all right? So next question is from Fish E Hunter AL. Is it cost effective to grow your own vegetables in a small backyard garden? So the answer is, depends on what you're growing and where you live, right? So I would say absolutely. I mean, the kale, you know, organic kale in South Florida, for example, is like $2.99, $3.99 a pound at the Whole Foods store. And you know, I'm gonna have so much kale in here, I will not be able to probably eat it all. I will dry it and juice it and all this stuff. You know, my peppers, I mean, peppers are really expensive, right? And so some plants will yield more per square foot in your garden than others. So for example, in general, root crops will produce, you know, better. So like sweet potatoes, one of the best things you guys could grow, because not only can you harvest the sweet potatoes, but you could also eat the leaves as well. So I totally believe that gardening can be beneficial, and especially growing things that money cannot buy or can be hard to find or are very expensive. You know, if I lived in South Florida, I'd be growing miracle berries, because I was looking at Amazon the other day, and on Amazon, like, I don't know, something stupid, like 25 freeze-dried miracle berries were selling for like, I don't know, $27 or $50, something stupid, silly. So yeah, so, you know, plan accordingly. You know, I wouldn't necessarily grow something like oranges if I lived in Southern California, because there's so many oranges, you can go down to the farmer's market and buy them for super cheap. But on the other hand, I would grow something like, I don't know, dragon fruits that sell for like $5 each, you know? So yeah, so choose the right crops to plant depending on your specific needs. Also, in many cases, I prefer to grow what grows really easy. You know, in the summer here, water spinach just grows like crazy. And water spinach here sells for like $2.99 a pound, whereas I have just basically unlimited poundage, as much as I could harvest in my backyard. So that definitely pays. So the next question is from Dr. Littlejohn. Best ways to prevent dampening off of microgreens. All right, so the best ways of preventing dampening off in microgreens is to have good practices. Don't overwater, right? Most important, I would say, have good airflow. Use a sterile soil. Those would be the ones at the top of my head. You know, if you're using compost, more likely to have dampening off than if using like the cocoa, you know, mats. So if you're using soil, you have a higher chance, or compost, you have a higher chance of dampening off than if you're using some kind of like sterile medium, like the plastic spun mats, which I'm not a fan of, or better yet, the coconut mats that the microgreens grower Larry in Baltimore, Maryland used. I'll put a link down below to his video so you could see his exact grow. And then also, of course, don't overwater. Now, the other thing that may be happening is have good quality seeds. If you have seeds that have some, you know, bacteria or growth on it, it can cause dampening off issues. So what you want to do is you want to basically take a quart of water and put in 4 teaspoons of vinegar and hydrogen peroxide in there, and then soak your seeds in that before germination to kind of maybe prevent that a little bit. But once again, it's not this or that. It's everything you do is causing some dampening off issues. All right, next question. Wow, it's pretty long. It's from Joe Ani. John, in this heat, my tree collards are under attack from insects. I was able to repel the caterpillars with 2 spray applications of BT plus soap and oil per your recommendation, but now I'm facing harlequin bugs, which started on my red leaf mustard and have migrated to my tree collards. I go out and pick them off, but there are always more. Other plants like Brazilian spinach and Gianera procumbens are doing fine in the heat, but how do you keep the tree collards healthy in the heat? Also, any tips to get Katuk to grow well? It does not grow many leaves here in Baltimore. All right, so the easy question first is, how do you get Katuk to grow well? I'd say move to Hawaii or South Florida, which provides the optimal climate for that plant. I probably think that it doesn't like cold overnight temperatures. It also likes it quite humid, which I think you have there in Baltimore. You know, my Katuk plant grows lots of leaves, but they're just not quite as healthy because the challenge here is it can handle, it's handling the 100 degree heat. The issue is I really don't think it likes the arid or the dry climate. When I spray down the leaves and make sure it's nice and wet in the soil, it always seems to perform better if I'm just watering the soil and I'm not spraying down the leaves and giving it some extra hydration. So I'm going to say that. So I'm not the expert on Katuk. And now on the tree collards, yes, harlequin bugs have been my bane, has been a pain for sure. And I had tons of them this year. I potentially lost some of my tree collard plants because of them and for other reasons. And I sprayed them with like neem, Dr. Bronner's, and they just basically laughed. They laughed at me. I couldn't believe when they're laughed. They're like little harlequin bugs. So then I'm like, and then I saw like there was some spinosad on sale at like one of the nurseries. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to buy this spinosad stuff because it's on clearance or something. So I bought the spinosad stuff and then I mixed that with the neem and Dr. Bronner's. And then I sprayed my plants and that took them out, man. That being said, my first preference before even spraying anything like that is to basically come out and smush them. So smush all those mothers you can, pick off the caterpillars before you even spray the BT. I'm not a big fan of spraying BT unless absolutely necessary in isolated areas. You know, manual control is always best. You know, the harlequin bugs, I mean, if you don't start smushing them as soon as you see them, they multiply and then you're kind of screwed, and then they lay eggs and they're going to be back next year. So yeah, the best I found for me personally was neem, Dr. Bronner's with the spinosad, which I'm not totally in agreement with, but I hate harlequin bugs even more. Okay. Next question is from MJ the Patriot. How much soil can you haul in the back of your Prius? LOL, love your video, by the way. Way awesome. Love to learn. All right, MJ. So number one, I've never owned a Prius. I have driven a Prius before. And I don't think I've hauled soil in the back of a Prius. I have hauled soil in the back of the Golf, Volkswagen Golf. And if my memory serves me correctly, I would usually get about 3/4 of a yard to a yard, I think. The main thing is just having containers to put it all in. The weight load was not an issue for me, although I probably was likely overloading my car. And you don't want to do that because you might bust a spring out or mess it up. So you want to, I mean, the main thing is the weight. So you want to check the load capacity of your car and how much the compost weighs, and then calculate how much you can haul safely. You know, I've also like overloaded my Jeep Liberty with like all these concrete blocks, and it definitely took me a couple of trips to get all these blocks because they're actually quite heavy. That thing was sagging a little bit too. So yeah, don't overload your car unless you're willing to risk the brake and getting stranded and stuck. Okay, so next question is from Patrick Prey. My Malabar spinach has slimy consistency when eaten. Is that typical or possibly due to how it's grown? Mine is a container plant in full sun. All right, Patrick. So many different greens or plants produce mucilaginous, I can't say that word. But anyways, some plants produce fibers that are quite slimy, right? And that's just how they are. So okra, you know, kind of a slimy vegetable, Malabar spinach, slimy vegetable, cactus, aloe vera, also kind of slimy that we can consider slimy. Nothing wrong with slimy. And a matter of fact, upcoming and emerging science shows some of this mucilage or these fibers that cause this sliminess are actually really good for our guts and our microbiome and our digestive system. So, I mean, all the Malabar spinach ever grown has always been slimy. So yeah, that's just totally normal. Don't be alarmed and eat it on up. All right, so the next question is from TXT, so it's like Texas T713. How do you store compost tea? So that's a good question. So number one, I don't recommend storing compost tea. I recommend making it and using it. Use it before you lose it is what Josh from Boogie Brew says. And I believe that also, you know, compost tea has active microbes in it. And if you store the tea, especially if you stored it improperly, the microbes will basically diminish over time. And it won't be worthless, but it's not good to store your compost tea. So use it, infuse it, and use it before you lose it. And that's what I'd say. So when I make compost tea, I literally, you know, turn off my bubbler, I drain it, and then I water it right in immediately. I do not store it. I do not put it in jugs. None of that stuff. Now, I do understand that, you know, if you do have a business, you're trying to sell compost tea, how can you do that? So I did talk to, I would consider a compost tea expert, actually the cannabis show. And I think in the video that was taken down through YouTube, unfortunately, which I'm going to end up reposting one of these days, I'm probably going to have to bleep out a lot of the words because YouTube banned it from being illegal or some BS, which was totally bogus. So I haven't had, and I got a strike on my channel because I've talking about cannabis and stuff, which I thought wasn't cool. Because I talk about gardening. I don't talk about like getting high or all these other things that people, if they want to do that in their own home where it's legal, where you do, that's fine. I don't really care. You know, I use cannabis every day myself. Like I ingest it, I eat high CBD strains, you know, as an adjunct to my healthy lifestyle. And generally I don't get high unless I eat too much of the stuff, and I don't heat process it. So yes, I'm still getting high off the raw stuff. But nonetheless, at that trade show, I met so many amazing people, and that video was so valuable. In the video, I talked about a guy, I talked to a guy that knows how to basically make the microbes go to sleep. And there's several methods. Let's see, I think temperature was one. I forget exactly all the ways, but I'd have to refer to that video because I probably mentioned it in that video that's not currently up. But yeah, for most people, you just want to use it. You don't want to sell it, you know, in a jug. Aaron Nova asks, do you have any thoughts on dry amendments? Absolutely. So while I use some liquid amendments, I use plenty of dry amendments. I have like a vegan fertilizer from Down to Earth. I have, you know, different kinds of rock dust, different kinds of worm castings. These I would consider all dry amendments. You know, I'm not a big fan of liquids for the most part. I mean, my pure protein is a solid that I rehydrate and then I water it in. I'm a big fan of those. And now, to me, dry amendments, the best way to apply dry amendments are, you know, maybe some people sprinkle them on and stuff. What I do is, you know, I literally added about 15 gallons of soil because I was like taking out 5 gallon buckets, maybe even 20 gallons of soil. No, more like 40 gallons of soil because I had 5 gallon buckets. I'd mix soil in my big wheelbarrow and I basically bring over buckets of soil and I basically layered on top this bed because the soil level had sunk down a little bit. I layered on top and then basically evened it out. So in the mixture I made, all my dry amendments went. So I have different kinds of insect frass and rock dust and worm castings and soil humates, maybe some vegan fertilizer mix, just basically put in there and then I spread it all out, biochar, I spread all that on here, and that's, so this is fully amended, and then I plant in it, and then my plants are totally happy. So yeah, big fan of dry amendments. Let's see, Wolf Smuck. Do you use chitin feed worm castings? And if so, does it work against caterpillars or other leaf-eaten insects? All right, so I do not make worm castings myself. The worm castings I do use, some of which, they are feeding chitin, so Worm Gold Plus, I do know they feed chitin. Also, the OGS castings that I like to use a lot you know, they are adding a chitin-based source into there. And if you are making your own worm castings, I do encourage you to use some chitin. Crab or shrimp cells, you know, probably the easiest things to source for most people in large bulk quantities, and then feed that to your worms. This can basically, when the worms digest the chitin, then they produce an enzyme in their guts known as chitinase, which then they poop out, which then is, if it is in the worm castings, and not all worm castings will have chitinase, only castings that are fed high chitin, you put that in your soil and it's said to basically impart the chitinase into the plant, and the chitinase basically digest the chitin. So basically when a bug that has an exoskeleton or the chitin in its shell eat the plant with the chitinase, it basically like melts them, for lack of a better kind of like word to explain what it does. And then they basically like, oh, I'm getting melted when I eat this because that's chitinase, and I'm gonna go to some other plant that does not have the chitinase in it. Then they'll go to your neighbors or find another place to eat. So yes, that I believe does work. Not all worm castings have it. I do use castings that have chitin. So will that work on against caterpillars? Probably not. Why? Caterpillars are soft-bodied insects. They're not hard-bodied insects. They have no chitin in their exoskeletons, as far as I'm aware, because they have no exoskeletons. And other leaf-eating insects. So yes, some leaf-eating insects, it will, such as aphids, I believe, have some chitin in there. Maybe some white flies, not exactly sure. But yeah, so it's going to work on select insects. But of course, also adding worm castings to your plants will make the plant's immune system stronger. And basically, if the protein content is high in your plant, then the bugs will go somewhere else because they cannot digest more, you know, complete proteins like we are able to. Next question is from Beth O. Sorry if you covered this, but can you do a series of videos on plants you can grow indoors? I live in a campus ATM and would love to practice my love for plants, but obviously I don't have space like you. So let me know, what vegetables can I grow in my room and use in my day-to-day life? All right, Beth. So I guess the question is, what vegetables can I grow in my room and use in my day-to-day life, right? And that's where the challenge arises. The challenge arises that if you grow, like, you know, some kale or lettuce, you know, could you be able to harvest a piece of a leaf of lettuce every single day? Well, once your plant got the size, if you harvest one leaf one day, it might take 3 days or 4 days to grow another leaf, and then you could pick that and eat that too. You know, tomatoes, you know, indoors, tomatoes aren't going to get too big, and they don't have enough sunlight energy to basically grow a lot. So, you know, my personal opinion is that maybe herb plants would be the best to grow, because you grow an herb plant. And when you're harvesting an herb plant, you're not like making a salad out of it. You might just use some herbs, like a little bit of dill in your recipe or a little bit of basil in your recipe as a flavoring agent, although I make salads out of basil or, you know, parsley or cilantro. But most people aren't going to do that. So I'd say herbs, number one. And then number two, I would say microgreens or sprouts. Because sprouts, you could literally, I mean, I grew sprouts the other day. I grew buckwheat sprouts in literally one day, 24 hours from start to finish. And boom, if you start some sprouts every day, you could eat them every day. If they are ready in one day, most sprouts are done in 3 to 4 days. But if you have a rotating schedule, so you start some seeds today, you start some the next day, you start some the next day, and then, you know, you harvest the few days, and then you start another batch of seeds, and you just keep the rotating cycle going. So you could have basically sprouts forever. Another thing I would grow is microgreens. You know, microgreens, you will need a little rack in your dorm or whatever at college, and you can basically start one tray a day, and you could harvest one tray a day. And if you did that, I would pretty much guarantee you that you'd probably be eating healthier than anybody else at your college, because they're probably not eating microgreens, and microgreens are 4 to 40 times more nutritious than their large size counterparts. All right. Next question is from APuzz13. Can I put my basil and parsley in the same small bed? So Andrew, you could do that. Now the challenge that's going to happen is that the parsley stays relatively small, you know, to the ground, and the basil will grow big and tall. My basil's probably pushing 5 feet tall now, and I don't know if I even have parsley growing it now. I usually grow it in the wintertime, but that usually stays maybe a foot tall. So if you put them in the same bed now, you know, the basil will grow tall, the parsley will shade it underneath. It might keep the parsley alive during the hot heat of the summer, and then it's going to come back in the winter, so that could be kind of a companion plant thing. But basically they're not going to be as productive, so I would encourage you to plant them separate. All right, next question is from Indiana Backyard Gardener. Can a squash plant be saved from vine borer, or should I just not waste the effort and start over? So I don't have vine borers where I live, although I have heard they can be quite nasty. So if your vine borer infestation is really bad, I would say just, you know, sacrifice the plant. There are many times in my garden, if a plant is too far gone or the insects are too bad. Actually, I had some harlequin bugs in this bed on this side that you guys mostly can't see. And I just sacrificed the plants because all the harlequin bugs were all in there. And I basically put down some plastic bag down below it, so if I shook it, any ones would fall in the bag. I cut the plant down, just totally disposed of that, got it off-site to get those buggers, literally buggers, away from here. So yeah, I would generally say not worth the effort and start over. Control your squash or your vine borer issue first, and then start over. Maybe get some squash plants that are more resistant to vine borer as well. All right, last question is from Stacks Urban Harvest. Hey, John, I want to preface my question with this. I've been a subscriber for your channel for years, and I've learned so much from you. You helped inspire me to start my own garden channel to help new gardeners with our many challenges in Zone 10 here in South Florida. Here's the funny thing. This morning, I was showing my friend Trisha photos of the vigorous Seminole pumpkin vines from seeds she sent me, and this morning I asked Trisha if she would do a casual Zoom chat with me that would go in my video I'm going to do about these Seminole pumpkins. Then she mentioned that you had her on your channel in 2011. I had no idea you did a video with her, and somehow I missed it. My question, would you mind if I use a short clip or a couple of short clips from that video when I have her on my channel? All right, Stack. So thanks for checking in. I'm glad to always share my content. My content is, freely available on YouTube, and I agree with all copyright claims or, rules, which means if you want to pull out segments of my video and put it into your video and make a whole new piece, I'm in complete agreement with that. The only thing I would ask is that you give a link to the original source. Say, hey, this is from John at Growing Your Greens. Check him out at his channel and give a link to my channel. That's all I ask. Now, I do also say that I do not want anybody re-uploading my content to another channel, because that may cause confusion and may associate me with things or things people do on other channels that I'm not in complete agreement with. So yeah, that's my answer to that. And that's the end of today's questions. If you guys enjoyed this Q&A, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, please be sure to share this video with somebody else that you guys could think it could help. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that come out every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Also, make sure to click the bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,500 episodes at this time on the YouTube channel, more than any other YouTuber that I know teaching gardening to teach you guys how to grow your own food. And I have a wealth of information, including on Seminole pumpkins and the cool Everglades tomatoes. I mean, I used to travel a lot, and due to COVID, I have not been traveling as much. But I make a lot of videos, many different places around the U.S. to basically share with you guys how you guys could grow your own food at home and become more independent and become a producer in our consumer society. So with that, my name is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.